Okay, welcome to this session on EHV2. Last session we started talking about human conduct, and we gave one description about human conduct. We are calling as human conduct model 1, and now we want to get into another description of human conduct. Of course, what we will discuss in this session will be just a brief discussion of this human conduct model 2. The details of this will be discussed in EHV3. So this will be discussed quite in detail in EHV3, but here briefly we'll like to introduce so that you can start working on it. So as mentioned in the last session, we can look at human conduct from different angles, giving rise to different formulations, different descriptions. We are looking into two formulations of human conduct, and we are calling it as model 1 and model 2. In model 1, we have seen the description of complete human conduct. So how this complete human conduct would look like. Of course, there we wanted to also discuss about when we are going up, you know, from lower activities of the self to the higher activities of the self, then how this conduct, which is not complete, would look like. But because of the shortage of time, we did not much discuss. So anyway, we had to, you know, kind of mention it briefly. So I will skip that part, and the notes will be provided in that connection. So in this session, we will move on to this model 2. So we'll try to investigate into another description of human conduct. So this human conduct can be described in a different way, though the basic, you know, understanding, the feeling, the thought will remain the same. But when it comes to describe the details of how a human being will perform, right, then depending upon our angle of perceiving this conduct, we'll have different formulations. So the second formulation, you know, which we are talking about now, may appear to be very different from the first formulation, but it is appearing different only in the sense that it is seen from a different angle. So let's look at that. So in model 2, the human conduct is articulated in terms of these three things: in terms of human values, in terms of policy, and in terms of character. So if you look at model 1, it was formulated basically in terms of right understanding, or understanding of coexistence, harmony, and relationship. Then feeling and thought of coexistence, which was in terms of having this feeling of being related to human being and being related to the rest of nature and so on. And then its expression in the behavior, in the work and so on. Now, here we are formulating it in terms of the basic human values, the fundamental, the universal human values, in terms of policy of how these values will be implemented, will be lived up to, and then character, which is the implementation of these human values. So let us look at this. So the human values means understanding what to do as a human being and what not to do as a human being. So what is to be done as human being will come under human value. What is not to be done as human being will not be human values, or you may call it, it will be inhuman values. So this has to be understood. To what is to be done by human being and what is not to be done by human being. And what is to be done by human being is human values. So if you remember, we said, what is my role in this existence? So that role that I have to play, you know, what is my participation in this existence? That participation is what we are calling as human values. And if we are participating otherwise, it is not human value, right? It is inhuman values. Second, the policy. So now, once we know what we have to do, the second issue is how to go about it. So how to do it? So details the thought of how to do, that is policy. So what to do, that clarity gives us human values. How to do what we have to do, right? The thought of it, the details of it, what we are calling as policy. So how to implement these human values, that thought, that detail is what we are calling as policy. And you can see that this includes plan, program, implementation, results, and evaluation. So all these aspects are included in policy, in the detail, in the thought of how to ensure fulfillment of human values. And then we are saying that this policy can be seen in terms of policy for enrichment, policy for protection, and policy for right utilization. Enrichment, protection, and right utilization, right? Of whatever means we have, available for implementation of these human values, we will have to work out what is going to be the policy for each one of them. What is going to be the policy for enrichment, policy for protection, policy for right utilization of whatever is available in nature, like for us, in order to implement this, our participation in the nature, in the existence. So there are three things which are available to us. One is our own self. Second is our body. And third is the rest of nature, you know, the physical facilities around. So these are the three things which we have with us to invest. Right. So how do we invest it? How do we invest these resources, these basic reality which are available in nature, the basic things which are available in nature for the enrichment of how do we go about ensuring the enrichment of these things? How do we go about ensuring the protection of these things? And how do we go about ensuring the right utilization of these things? So all that is available in nature for us to live with, how do we go about ensuring the enrichment, protection, and right utilization of it? And whatever is available is these three things, right? So self, body, and the rest of nature. So this is what we are calling as policy for enrichment, policy for protection, and policy for right utilization. The third thing is the character. Character is what we are performing in the world outside with our clarity of values, with our clarity of policy. Now we are implementing it in the world outside, in our behavior, in our work, in our participation in the larger order. So how does it look there? That is character. So if you look at the character, there are three major parts. The first and the foremost part is our behavior and work with rest of nature, with the nature as such. So compassionate behavior and work and participation in the larger order on the basis of human values. So this is first important part of the character. And if you expand on it, right, it reflects in terms of my behavior. Behavior with human being, ensuring justice, ensuring mutual happiness. Then work, ensuring preservation and mutual prosperity with nature, with rest of nature. We have mentioned something more in the bracket. What it says is that when I am behaving with human being, I have to understand the feeling, I have to ensure that feeling in myself. And I have to share this feeling with the other, ensuring justice, ensuring mutual fulfillment with the other human being. So this is what I have to do at present. But many times you will find that when you are performing this, the other is not, you know, receiving it in that sense. And one of the reasons could be that he is, you know, he has complained from my behavior in the past. And he's carrying on this. In that case, not only that I have to ensure fulfillment in the relationship at this point of time with my understanding and with my feeling, but I have to do something to compensate for what I have not done in the past, what has created lack of trust, lack of affection. Right? So it is written, while also filling the gaps created in ignorance. So in case of behavior, in case of work, when I'm interacting with human being, when I'm interacting with the rest of nature, then I have to take care of both the present behavior and also compensation for the past misbehavior. When I'm working, I have to take care of this mutually fulfilling, you know, and reaching work with the rest of nature. And if there is already some problem created in the past, we will have to, you know, compensate for it. So if I decide to do organic farming, and if my soil is spoiled because of the use of inorganic fertilizers and so on, then not only that I have to do, you know, kind of what I have to do for organic farming, you know, providing the organic manures and all that, but I also have to do something to take care of the, you know, thing or inorganic material which has been accumulated because of my past work. Similarly, when I'm interacting with the forest, if a lot of trees have already been cut, then not only that I have to protect the forest, but I have to plant trees in the forest. That is the compensation. That is filling the gaps created in ignorance. The second thing which is important in character is rightfully acquired wealth. So the wealth, the physical facility that we are using, it is rightfully acquired. And we will see what is the meaning of rightfully acquired. I mean, the simple meaning would be that what I have acquired in a rightful manner. But little description of that will help, that we will do in the next slide. And the third is that we have this relationship, you know, in the family between husband and wife, where I maintain the chastity in my conjugal relationship. So these three important parts of character. One is compassionate behavior in work and participation in the larger order on the basis of human values. Second is rightfully acquired wealth. And third is chastity in conjugal relationship. Of course, you can have many more details, but this is some important details about the character. And if you look at the I think I'll come back to this this rightfully acquired wealth when we describe this further. But let us start with this human values first. So if we look at the human values, when we were talking about human-human relationship, we have talked about this value of trust, respect, affection, like those nine values in human-human relationship. And we did it quite extensively in UHB1. So in the context of human-human relationship, we have talked about these values. We have gone into quite extensive detail of it. So that is one set of values which relating to human-human relationship. Then my relationship with myself, right? There also we talked about these values. In last three sessions, we have mentioned it again and again, that if you look at the self, and if you look at the self which is in harmony, right, under the realization of coexistence, then we are in a state of bliss, satisfaction, peace, and happiness. And this all put together is continuous happiness. So this continuous happiness is the value, when I see in my relationship with the self. So the values relating to self is continuous happiness, which can be described further in terms of bliss, satisfaction, peace, and happiness. This we have talked about already. Then third thing that we talked about was that when I'm interacting, when I'm participating in the larger order, starting from family order to village to nation, so on, then I have to have this feeling of perseverance, gravity, generosity, so on, ultimately the compassion. So these are another set of values which relate to my participation in the larger order, in the social system. And one more, when I look at my, what I have to do in my relationship with the rest of nature. So that is the fourth category that we have to briefly look into. So if you look at your participation with rest of nature, the basic value would be ensuring the nurturing, the protection, and the right utilization of rest of nature. So that is going to be the basic value. When I'm interacting with rest of nature, I have to ensure, or I at least have to have the feeling of ensuring the enrichment of rest of nature, protection of rest of nature, and right utilization of rest of nature. And this value, or this feeling of ensuring this enrichment, protection, and right utilization of the rest of nature, is expressed in terms of this utility value and the artistic value. So we'll see little bit of this detail also. So with this, I can evaluate our present status, that are we aware of these values? And are we taking care of them? So if you look at this, you would realize that the way the whole civilization is going, at the most we are paying attention to these values related to my interaction with rest of nature. So the major focus is on this: how to acquire physical facility, how to protect physical facility, how to, you know, utilize physical facility. The focus is not even on right utilization. It is more on consumption, more on indulgence than the right utilization. But that is what is at focus at the most. So see whether this is true or not true. So if you go about identifying these human values, they have just written it down, being in harmony in this self on the basis of realization of coexistence. We have this happiness, peace, satisfaction, and bliss in this self. So this is the values relating to this self. Then we have participation in the universal order or universal human order as a human being with human consciousness. That is perseverance, bravery, generosity, kindness, beneficence, and compassion, which we have been talking about right from the first course. Third is participation in human-human relationship. That is what we call as justice. And we have studied in detail that they have this, we have these nine established values like trust, respect, affection, and so on. And these established values are expressed in terms of the expressed values. So we'll look into those expressed values as we go little further. So we have these nine established values in human-human relationship, and similarly we have nine expressed values. And the fourth one is this participation in the human rest of nature relationship. And there we have this utility value and the artistic values. So these are the human values, you know, which are there by very design of the nature, by very design of the existence, and the design of human being. So when we talk about human conduct, first we have to understand these human values. Only when we understand these human values, we can work out the policy for it and ensure our character in accordance with it. So this is about this value relating to the self. There are some description. I will just read it out. So in this self, that value is related to the self, happiness is basically indicating the harmony at the level of selecting and testing. Harmony at the level of selecting and testing. And this harmony at the level of selecting and testing is ensured when my selection is based on goal and values, and my sensation is guided by this goal and value. Or in the other words, my selecting is guided by coexistence, harmony, and relationship. And my sensation is under the guidance of coexistence, harmony, and relationship. And in another term, the selecting and testing is guided by comparing and analyzing, which we will see. This piece has to do with harmony at the level of analyzing and comparing. That is, my analyzing is on the basis of coexistence, harmony, and justice. And this is what is guiding the senses, the health, the profit. Based comparing. So this we have talked about. You know, about the happiness, about the peace. And ultimately about the bliss. So bliss is a state of harmony, is the level of determination and understanding. And this understanding is the clarity about the harmony in nature. Determination is the decision to live with this harmony in nature. And this takes place when this understanding and determination is guided by realization and authentication. So only when this realization is there of coexistence, that understanding is guided by this realization. And there is a feeling of bliss at the level of understanding. So this is what we have talked about already. So I'm not going into the details. So this is just the description about these four things, about the harmony, about the peace, about the satisfaction, and about the bliss. I mean, these are important, you know, to understand, because we can evaluate our status. That are we in a state of harmony at the level of selecting and testing? At the level of expectation? Are we in a state of harmony at the level of analyzing and comparing? At the level of thought? Are we in harmony at the level of desire? The level of contemplation and imaging. And similarly, are we in harmony at the level of understanding, at the level of determination? And we can see that all this will happen when I have the realization of coexistence. And this realization of coexistence is guiding my understanding, which is guiding my contemplation, which is guiding my comparing, which is guiding my testing. So that's what we said in the last session, that complete human conduct is ensured on the basis of having the realization of coexistence and not otherwise. So unless we have this realization within of coexistence, there is no way for us to ensure the harmony at the level of understanding and determination. That is feeling of bliss, harmony at the level of contemplation and imaging, and so on. So all this harmony at the lower level is ensured only when these lower level activities are taking place under the guidance of realization of coexistence. Otherwise, there will be some disharmony, some contradiction at one of these places. There we'll have a lack of fulfillment, or we'll not have the continuity of happiness. Then participation in the universal order as human being. So when I'm participating in the system, in the universal order, then what is going to be my participation? So this we have defined before, very briefly, of course, in EHP1. But we have talked about it, but now we can, you know, kind of place these definitions here. So this perseverance is commitment for living in harmony at all four levels with patience. This patience is important. So not only that, after understanding this harmony in nature, in existence, I have the commitment for living in harmony at all these four levels, and I'm making efforts. But In addition, I have to have the patience that when I am trying to work on it, it is not necessary that I will get the cooperation from the environment and particularly from other human beings. Right. At some time, there is a likelihood of opposition also. Because if the other person is not able to see the harmony in the nature, in the existence, then he is not able to see this participation. So he does not have the acceptance for it. And if he is perceiving otherwise, he might even have opposition for it. So when I understand the harmony in nature at all four levels, and if I am feeling committed to work for it, then when I am working for it, I may or may not get the cooperation from others, or I might even have the opposition from others. But in all these conditions, I have the patience. I have this realization that yes, it will take time for the other to accept, because unless he understands this, unless he has the acceptance for this, he cannot appreciate. He cannot appreciate. So not only that, not that he wants to oppose me, but his competence is missing, to understand what I'm doing and to cooperate in that. So this is about commitment for living in harmony at all four levels with patience. And that is what is perseverance. This brevity has to do with helping the other. So not only that I want to understand and live in harmony with patience, but I have this commitment for helping the other to understand harmony and to live in harmony. So brevity is this feeling that not only that I have to have the right understanding or understanding of harmony and living in harmony, but I have to help the other because this is a need for the other as well. And in relationship, I have my commitment. So to ensure fulfillment of relationship with human being, to ensure my participation in the larger order, in the human order, I have to have this commitment for helping the other to understand harmony and to live in harmony. And of course, this is a feeling which is very naturally acceptable to us. The third is generosity. Generosity is the commitment to invest oneself, body and physical facility for understanding and living in harmony at all four levels, for myself and for others. So once I'm able to see that ultimately the purpose is to ensure understanding and living in harmony at all levels, then I will invest all that I have. I will invest myself, I'll invest my body, and I will invest the physical facilities that I have for this, ensuring this understanding and living in harmony. So this commitment to invest oneself, body and physical facility for understanding and living in harmony is called generosity. So it is not that I'm just giving away things. I'm giving things with this responsibility, with this commitment to invest my own self, body and the physical facility for ensuring understanding and living in harmony at all four levels. So this is about the generosity, one of the values of my participation in the universal order, in the larger order. Then another three values relating to this participation in the universal order, the kindness, the beneficence, and the compassion. So kindness is providing means to one who has the ability but not the means. So if somebody has the ability to do something and he does not have the means, then providing this means, you know, is what is calling, what is called as feeling of kindness. On the other hand, if the other person has the means, but he does not have the competence, then this commitment to develop that commitment, that competence in the other, is what we are calling as beneficence. So helping the other to develop the competence, utilize the means they already have. So there are many people who have this piece of information regarding any knowledge. But they don't see the importance of it, or they don't have time to work for it. So that competence part is missing, even though the information is there. So to help the other develop the competence to utilize the means that they already have is what we are calling as beneficence. And lastly, the compassion. Compassion is that I have the commitment for the other to improve upon the other unconditionally. So if he does not have the competence, I will develop the competence or help in developing the competence. If he does not have the means, I will help him to get the means. So helping the other unconditionally to develop the competence as well as the means to fulfill his needs when he neither has the ability nor the means. So if he's missing both, then I have the commitment to help him to develop both the means, the competence. So this is about the six values relating to participation in the human order, universal order. And this participation in the human-human relationship as a human being, we have already discussed quite in extensive detail in HB1. So I will not kind of talk about this in detail. We've just defined it for your ready reference. But what I will discuss is these established values. They are called established values, these nine values that we have been talking about. They are expressed in the, you know, in our behavior by way of expressed values. And if you look at this expressed values, that is how they look like. So if I have a feeling of trust in me, that established value, then in my relationship, in my expression, in terms of behavior outside, I will do it in as complementarityness. So if I have the feeling of trust on the other, I will be, you know, trying to become complementary to him. So this complementarityness is the expressed value of the value of trust. So as a result, we are able to work together. So we can work together only when we have this feeling of being complementary to each other. And we can have this feeling of complementarity to each other only when at the base we have the feeling of trust for each other. So trust is expressed through this complementariness. And as an indicator, we can see that we are able to work together. Similarly, if we have this feeling of affection, it will be expressed in terms of my commitment. Right? And when I'm living with somebody with commitment, we can see this indicator that we are self-motivated for fulfilling our responsibility in relationship. So whatever is our responsibility in relationship, we are self-motivated. We are very, you know, forthcoming for fulfilling that responsibility in relationship. So like that, you can see, we have feeling of care, then it will be expressed in terms of generosity, where I will invest whatever I have, myself, my body, my physical facility, for taking care of those, you know, for whom I have this feeling of care. So like that, we have defined this 9 expressed values, this complementariness as expressed value of trust, then compliance, transparency as expressed value of respect, then commitment as expressed values of affection, and so on. Generosity as the expressed value of care. So these are the 9 expressed values which are used for expression of the established value that we have been talking about. The last one I would mention, that if we have the feeling of love, then it is expressed in terms of treating the other as myself and no different. So now there is no other. The other I am treating as myself. So I am the other. That is called unanimity. No difference with the other, or identification completely with the other. So if I am identifying myself completely with the other, then one of the indicators will be that I am living with the feeling of coexistence. Living with the feeling of relationship with every unit in existence. So if I am able to do that, it is an expression of my feeling of love, feeling of being related to everyone. So if I have the feeling of being related to everyone, then I will live in relationship of mutual fulfillment with every unit in nature in existence. Then this participation in human rest of nature relationship. So the values related to my participation with the rest of nature, if you look at it, we have these two values, the utility value and the artistic value. The utility value is described in terms of, you know, what is required for nurturing the body, in protecting the body, in enriching capacity of body for use in societal development. So if I look at a thing, this physical thing can be used for the purpose of nurturing the body, for the purpose of protecting the body, and it can also be used for some purpose of the self, right? And that would be in terms of body for use in societal development. So enriching the capacity of the body for use in societal development, in that, you know, that is what we are calling as right utilization of the physical facility. So to take an example, if we have to communicate with each other something for right education, for right sanskar, we are using this internet facility. And by using this internet facility, what we are doing, we are enhancing the capacity of the body. So my voice cannot reach you directly over this distance, but through this internet facility, my voice is able to reach to you. And what is the use of this voice? Ultimately, it is for the purpose of societal development, for the purpose of developing my relationship with you, for the purpose of working for a system in the society. So the utility value of any physical facility, any unit, is in terms of this. In nurturing the body, in protecting the body, or enriching the capacity of the body for use in societal development. The second one is this artistic value, facilitating enrichment, protection, and right utilization. So whatever we have described up, you know, that is being facilitated through artistic value. So three things we are saying. First is protecting the physical facility. So we are using certain physical facility. We have to protect it, right? For example, if you put a paint on any machine which is made of iron, then it protects it from environment and protects it from getting rust. The second aspect of artistic value is making it people friendly. So the thing that we were utilizing, it can be made people friendly. That is facilitating behavior, making it convenient for sharing, expressing, or receiving knowledge, feeling, and thought. So this is also important, that when we are interacting with other human beings and using the physical facility for that purpose, then this artistic value will help us to facilitate this transaction, this sharing. So if I am saying something, instead if I write it down with bullet points, it might facilitate my sharing the information with you. If a colorful slide is made, or if supportive documentaries are also presented, then probably this communication will become more effective. So this comes under this artistic value, that we are able to make this transaction, you know, of physical facility, you know, people friendly, facilitating the behavior in the process of this transaction. And third is ease in use, facilitating work, making it convenient for usage. For example, when I'm holding something with my hand and moving it for a distance, and if it is sharp edged, then it is going to create inconvenience for the body. If I make it round edged, then it is convenient for the hand to hold. So this is regarding the values related to my relationship with the rest of nature. So all this put together is, you know, those values that we are talking about is. Values related to the self, related to universal human order, related to human-human relationship, and related to human rest of nature relationship. And of course, we need to take care of all of them. While presently we are, you know, taking care of only the two, and not at that too, not to full extent. So with these values, now we can talk about the policy. So this policy has to do with the details, with the thought of how to do it. And if we expand this, this is what will appear as human constitution. So we have policy for enrichment of self, body, and physical facility. We have policy for protection, and we have policy for right utilization. So this policy for right utilization, which is the first priority, this is also important to see that right utilization is the first priority over enrichment and protection, so that you can sort out for yourself whether right utilization is the first priority or protection or enrichment. For all three, which one is the highest priority? So for right utilization, what is going to be the policy? So if you look at the right utilization of self, we have to have the policy for investing the self for self-study and practice and authenticating in living. So the right utilization of self would mean that self is able to reach to that state of right understanding, right feeling, and right thought, therefore living with continuous happiness. Right. So if I am making a policy for right utilization of the self, I have to have the way by which the self can explore, investigate, starting from his activity of selecting and testing, and move up to the realization and authentication. And once it is able to realize the coexistence, then providing the opportunity, the conditioneness, so that he can line up all his activity according to this realization of coexistence, and finally express it in terms of his behavior, his work, and so on. So all that we have talked about, the development of the self, all that has to be supported by the policy. So policy for right utilizing the self will mean policy for investing the self for self-study, practice, and ultimately authenticating in living. So providing the facility, the education to the self, so that it can move from the lowest activity to the highest activity, and then line up all the lower activities in terms of the higher activity, so that it is in a state of harmony within and a state of continuous happiness within. That is the right utilization of the self. Then right utilization of the body. So policy to ensure that the body is used for ensuring right understanding and right feeling in the self, as well as authentication in living, including behavior, work, and participation in the larger order. So the right utilization of the body is first to facilitate the self for its self-realization. And once that realization has taken place, facilitate the self to express it in terms of behavior, work, and participation in the larger order. If that is happening with the body, then it is the right utilization of the body. Then right utilization of physical facility. Policy to ensure the use of physical facility for nurturing, protection, and right utilization of the body. Policy for right utilization of physical facility for relationship and societal order. So right utilization of physical facility will be three things. One is for the health of the body. Right. Second is use of physical facility for fulfillment in relationship. And third is for the fulfillment of or participation in the societal order. So right, and the physical facility is rightly utilized when it is used for ensuring health of the body, that is nurturing and protection of the body. When it is used for fulfillment of relationship, when it is used for ensuring participation in the societal order. So when we say policy for right utilization of physical facility, we'll have to make policy for ensuring that physical facility is used for these three purposes. For nurturing and protection of body, for right utilization, in fulfillment and relationship and participation in the society. Lord, similarly, we have policy for protection, for self, policy for ensuring conducive environment and protecting from unfavorable environment. So in right utilization of self, we are ensuring the policy for providing the right, you know, environment so that self can evolve itself. When it comes to protection, we are protecting it from any otherwise environment. So we have to have the policy for that. Then policy for protection of the body is policy for ensuring shelter, clothes, etc., so that body is protected. And policy for protection of physical facility is policy for proper storage and things like that. Then policy for enrichment, which is the third priority. So enrichment of the self, we have to have the policy for education and sanskar. We have to have this adult education, other efforts for development of sanskar in the society through music, dance, drama, and so on. So all this will be for enriching the self, enriching the understanding in the self, the feeling in the self. Enrichment of the body would mean the policy for it will be the policy for intake and lifestyle to ensure health of the body. And policy for enrichment of physical facility will be policy for production with right process and right skills. So when we are saying enrichment of the physical facility, we have to involve in production. But this production has to be with right process and right skill, so that on the one hand, it takes care of the prosperity of human being, and on the other hand, it is able to preserve the rest of nature. So this is regarding the policy. And now finally, regarding the character, we have to have this compassionate behavior, work, and participation in the larger order on the basis of human values. So we have to have this behavior, which is ensuring justice, the mutual fulfillment. And we have to have this work, which is ensuring preservation and mutual prosperity, which I just mentioned. And here we have mentioned that not only that we have to ensure this mutual fulfillment in behavior and mutual fulfillment in work, but if there has been any gap created in the past because of lack of such behavior and work, then that also has to be compensated. And I took this example that if forest, you know, we have to interact with the forest, we can interact with this in a mutually enriching manner. But if the trees have been cut and the mountain has been denuded, then the normal thing will not work. We'll have to do something to compensate for, you know, the damage that we have done, the lack of our fulfillment with the rest of nature that has resulted into this. So we'll have to compensate for that. So that is what we are saying by also filling the gaps created in the knowledge. The second thing is that rightfully acquired wealth. Right. So some description about this, rightfully acquired wealth. So there are three possibilities. One is production through labor on rest of nature, or physical facility obtained in exchange of service. That is physical facility endowed with utility value and artistic value. So this is what we are producing, physical facility. So if I am acquiring this physical facility on the basis of production, on the basis of my work on rest of nature, or if I am getting it in return to the service that I am providing to the other human being. So this is what is called as rightfully acquired wealth. So one category of it is this, that either through production or through service, I am able to get some physical facility. In both the case, I am involving my labor with rest of nature. Second is this gift. This wealth which is shared willingly, happily from one's rightfully acquired wealth on various occasions like festivals. So this gift which we have ourselves produced and we are sharing it with others willingly in our relationship. Not that it is taken away, no. If it's taken away by force, by manipulation, it is an exploitation. Third is the award. The physical facility, the wealth given with joy in a function to recognize one's contribution to society and for motivating others. So if it comes as an award, this also will come under the category of rightfully acquired wealth. So these three category, number one is either I get it out of production or service. Second is I get it as a gift in my relationship, or I get it as an award in the society, which is for doing something meaningful for the society, which society wants to promote and motivate others for. So with these three things, I will just sum up. So we have the human values in human conduct. So the basic is the human values. And of course, the basis of this human value is the right understanding. So with right understanding, we have the human values. And these human values are definite. They are intact. They are invariant. They are universal. And that is what we have been talking about. Right. So this is at the level of realization and understanding. That is B1. At that level, we are able to understand what is human values. Then policy, that is the detail of how to do. So this working out the policy is at the level of thought, that is block B2. And then character, this is the expression at the level of behavior, work and participation in the larger order. So this includes B1, guiding B2, guiding the behavior, the work, the participation in the larger order. So what we had called as B3 and B4. Now you can see that this human values is something which is definite, which is intact, which is invariant, which is universal. But when it comes to policy and character, there is a scope for creativity. So depending upon the local conditions and the customs and the language, right, there will be some variation at the level of policy and at the level of character. So take an example. When I say with the body, my values will be always nurturing the body and not harming the body. But when it comes to implementing this nurturing the body, I may decide to eat rice or wheat or maize, right? This will depend upon the climate in which I am living, the type of soil and so on. So if there is a place where rice can be grown easily, because of the rain and all those things, then I'll choose rice to nurture my body. But if it is a place where rice cannot be grown, maize can be grown, then I will choose to eat maize to nurture my body. So these values are remaining the same, universal, unchanging, invariant. But when we try to implement these values or live with these values, the policy and the character has lot of scope for creativity. So this we should understand. And what we have to keep intact in this whole process is the values. So values have to be there intact at the base, and then we can work out the policy and the character with our creativity, depending upon the local conditions, the customs, the languages, and so on. So with this, I can just sum up that this model 2 of human conduct would look like having the clarity about the human values and acceptance for it, working out the policy of how to live with these human values, and finally, living with these human values, you know, in the world outside in terms of our character. So with this, I will stop my presentation on human conduct model 2, and I can just give you some points for reflection before we open to question. So these 4 points, are you able to distinguish between 4 states in yourself, the happiness, peace, satisfaction, and bliss? So we have talked about these 4, you know, state of the self at different levels of activity. Are you able to see this difference? Second, observe yourself and identify the places where you can have more perseverance, bravery, and generosity for others. So when you look at yourself, you can see you have an acceptance for this perseverance, bravery, and generosity. But to what extent are you able to ensure it? Right? And what improvement you think is required? So what are the places you can have more of this perseverance and bravery and generosity? The third point for self-reflection is detail out how this human character will show up in your case. So these 3 parts, you know, how will it show up in case of yourself? How this human character will show up, you know, in your compassionate behavior, work, and participation in the larger order, in your behavior, in your work, how it will show up in your rightfully acquired wealth, and how it will show up in terms of chastity in conjugal relationship. What would it mean for you? Also evaluate your present state as compared to the desired state. So this is the desired state of human character, and how, what is your condition presently? Work out some details of form of these policies in the present day, these 3 policies in the present day society. So if these values have to be implemented, then what will be the form of policies? These 3 policies that we have talked about, try to do some work on it, try to expand on it, and see how these values can be implemented today in the given society. What will be the form of policy for protection, for enrichment, and for right utilization of self, body, and physical facility? So, lot of work.